Connectics, I request Dr. Arunachalam and Dr. Arvind, please come to. Now I request to Dr. Speaker M. Gopal Krishna also, please come. Now I request Dr. Arunachalam to do the proceeding.
She married Dr. K. Saudi Rajan, alumni of Stanley Medical College, who was a counselor, MLC at Chennai, after resigning from her job to supplement the aspirations of all around her. She joined Kasturba Gandhi Hospital, Triplicane, to serve as an honorary assistant surgeon for over 18 years. She cleared her DGO to stay updated, started her private practice, Anuradha Maternity Center, Thandabani Street, Dinagar, in 1964, qualified as an MD and obstetric gynecologist by 1979 from the Madras University. She joined the Egmore Maternity Hospital as an honorary civil surgeon. She also functioned as a professor for Madras Medical College during this period. She served in the medical panel of several corporate houses. She has traveled widely and participated in conferences in Chennai and abroad. Her children are also doctors and even grandchildren. As a woman, Dr. Rukmani Saudarajan has been impeccable as a mother, spending quality time with the family, very well connected to all the community she served and belonged. A sterling performer, most sought after doctor both in private practice and the honorary service rendered at the government hospitals. As a professor, guided and mentored hundreds of medical students. As a practitioner, she could connect to the society very well due to her versatile linguistic proficiency. She could speak Tamil, Telugu, Hindi and English. She was deemed a part of every family. She gifted a safe motherhood during her 40 years of service. I think every member who is going to be an oration sponsor should have a like this profile, so that the new generation know what was. And it is really an honor to remain along with all of you, such a great professional of ours during her period. Now, hand over the mic to Dr. Arvind.
Thank you, Dr. Arunachalam. Incidentally, Professor Rukmani Saudarajan was my teacher way back in the 80s at MLC. So, a brief CV about our Professor N. Gopalakrishnan, his educational qualifications, MBBS MDTM, and MRCT from the UK and FRCT. Currently, he is the first director and head Institute of Nephrology, Madras Medical College. He is the first director to occupy that post. His accomplishments are established direct places services at Government Chengalpattu Medical College, started the ACS Donor Renal Transplant Program at Government KMC Hospital, and is currently heading the vibrant ACS Donor Transplant Program at Madras Medical College. He has about 50 research publications and he has authored 10 chapters and textbooks, and is a recipient of over 10 Oration Awards. And a scientific committee member of Indian Society of Nephrology, Indian Society of Organ Transplantation, and the PD, Petrol Dialysis Society of India. He is an institution ethics committee member of MMC, chairman ethics committee of Ovandrur Hospital, and chairman of MMC Nephrology Alumni Association, research board member of the Tamil Nadu Dr. MJR Medical University, Asia Regional Board Member, International Society of Nephrology, ISN, and American Nephrologist of Indian Origin Association, CKD committee member, and ICMR core committee member, and global burden diseases for operator, and of course, institute body member of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences and selection committee member. Over to Professor Gopalakrishnan, please.
Now I request Dr. Kasi Sanadhan to come forward with garland, Dr. Gopalakrishnan.
Thank you.
And I request Dr. Eddie Harris and our past president to come forward. Please, sir. So put a shawl on Dr. Gopal.
Secretion of acid in response to various stimuli, starting from acetylcholine or gastrin or histamine and so on. This is called as the proton pump. A drug which inhibits this proton pump will inhibit acid secretion. What is the importance of this drug? When I was an undergraduate in the 80s in Madurai Medical College, almost every day, if you go into the operation theater, in the theater list, there will be a couple of patients with frontal vagotomy with gastrojejunostomy. The asymptomatic disease, you know, duodenal ulcer and all that, it used to be such a common disease with huge morbidity and lot of cost implications and so on. Then came the H2 receptor antagonist in the 80s, like a godsend, to start with cimetidine and subsequently ranitidine and so many other molecules that thoroughly mitigated the occurrence of the peptic ulcer disease and so on. The later addition was the proton pump inhibitor, which is much more efficient than H2 receptor antagonist in reducing the acid secretion. But that is the glorious aspect of it. Nowadays, the younger generation doesn't even know existence of such a surgery for peptic ulcer disease. It is a very welcome change. But what has happened? What is the current situation? Of course, these are the definite indications for pump indicator, the short term for gastric ulcer and duodenal ulcer, and the three important indications for the long term use. One is the gastroesophageal reflux disease and the barrett's esophagus, and as a prophylaxis in those who have suffered an episode of bleed due to NSAID, and there is a compelling indication to continue NSAID as a prophylaxis against bleeding, NSAID-induced bleeding. So these are the definite indications for long-term use. Beyond this, there is no absolute indication for PPI. But what is the current situation? Current situation is pathetic. No? PPI is one of the most prescribed medicines and most talked. Without a definite indication. And even if there's an indication, the PPI is used, it is not stopped at all, it is continued for long. It is a global phenomenon, it is not just confined to India. So what are the data existing? Look at the data from United States. According to one particular study, in admitted patients, about 57% of them are on PPI, and outpatients, about 50% of them are on PPI. In a particular study. In 2013 alone, about 15 million people used prescription PPIs. And also in USA, PPI is available over the counter. Even without prescription, people are using it. So the total number of patients, actual number of patients who are on PPI is much greater than this 15 million. And it is a huge market to the tune of about $10 billion per annum. Right? And the pathetic story is that anywhere between 20 to 75% of such users, there was no definite indication for PPI. And this applies to all the countries in the world, including India. So that is the problem. See, this picture nicely depicts the. Yeah. So this, as you can see here, the number of users without prescription, the non-institutional prescription, from 3%, around 3.2%, it has gone to 7% over a period of time. But also see here, from 2000 onwards, there are good number of articles getting published on the potential problems associated with PPI-ASCOM. Both are increasing. So we are not sensitized about the flip side of PPI. We are happily ignorant about it. So today's lecture is that, just to wave an awareness. And the whole gets this high tide that we get sensitized about the potential consequences of unnecessary and long-term PPI use. What are they? So these are the potential problems. One is like enteric infections. The most worrisome is the Clostridium difficile and the community acquired pneumonia, the fractures, increased incidence of risk for dementia, gastric carcinoids, gastric cancer and colorectal cancer, hyponatremia, ischemic heart disease, and the very disturbing phenomenon of my own field, that is the kidney disease. Let us see quickly about each one of them. While there is increased risk of infections and that, the pH is altered, pH is altered, so the acidity is not there, so the vulnerability for the overgrowth of the organism is there, including non-typhoidal salmonella and campylobacter and so on, and increased incidence of Clostridium difficile infection and pneumonia, and in cirrhotics and so on, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis incidence increases in long-term PPI use because of altered the gut permeability and so on, increased bacterial overgrowth and increased toxin production and altered gut permeability. So these are all reported in various studies in long-term PPI users. Why there is increased vulnerability for bone fracture? Because of hypochlorhydria, the calcium absorption is reduced, and due to multiple other factors, many studies have revealed in those on long-term PPI, the bone mineral density is reduced, making them vulnerable for risk factors. But these data are inconsistent, and some authors don't accept it. So, as of now, we don't have different data to say that, but it is suffice to understand that there is increased vulnerability for bone fracture due to chronic PPI use. Why dementia? Dementia is due to accumulation of the beta amyloid protein. Normally what happens is that the microglial cells in the brain, they cause degradation of beta amyloid protein by B-type-8-PAs. But PPI causes inhibition of this enzyme, so there will be accumulation of beta amyloid protein in the brain, so making dementia at a higher risk in those. So according to this particular study, there is a 38% increased risk for dementia in long-term PPI users. And why gastrointestinal cancer risk? Increased gastrin levels in those on PPI. So gastrin has got tropic effect on the colonic epithelial cells, resulting in colorectal cancer risk. Also increased gastric carcinoids has been reported. And because of the pan-gastric colonization with Helicobacter pylori in chronic PPI users, that also is a vulnerability for cancer, right? And I said there is increased myocardial infarction risk in those who are on PPI. There are two important mechanisms they propose. One, the PPI is metabolized by this particular cytochrome P450 enzyme, CYP2319. The clopidogrel is activated by the same enzyme. It has to get activated to exert its antiplatelet action. When the enzyme is utilized for metabolism of PPI, it is not available to the same extent for activation of clopidogrel. So PPI may interfere with clopidogrel's antiplatelet action. So this is a major worry. But one study, Progen study published in NEJM, they accepted that this is happening, but they compared one randomized controlled trial. In the cohorts, according to that particular study, it is there, but it is not very clinically significant and so on. But there are at least a couple of other studies which vouch on this mechanism that will certainly increase the ischemic heart disease risk. There's one more mechanism, that is PPA, long-term PPA can decrease the nitric oxide synthase production. Nitric oxide in the vascular endothelium is our friend. It's important to maintain the value of the functionality of the endothelial system. When the nitric oxide comes down, there can be endothelial dysfunction, increased vascular reactivity, and that can lead to this. So this particular study published in PLOS One, about 9 to 16% increased risk of myocardial infarction in chronic PPA users, those who are using it for more than 4 years. So this is another worrisome factor. Then he said about hypomagnesemia. It is very well documented. Why is it happening is that PPA interferes with magnesium absorption in the gut. Magnesium absorption in the gut happens through two important carrier proteins. Transient receptor potential membrane 6 and transient receptor potential membrane 7. Inhibition of these important carrier proteins results in magnesium reduction in the magnesium absorption in the gut. So that results in hypomagnesemia. What is the problem of hypomagnesemia? Hypomagnesemia is often an ignored problem. We are hardly ignoring about it. It can cause a lot of havoc in the sense that severe hypomagnesemia can even result in totally high conversions and cardiac arrhythmia. And it is a potential cause for sudden death, particularly those who are on chronic maintenance dialysis. And a chronic mild hypomagnesemia can add risk for diabetes, osteoporosis, cardiovascular disease, and even can result to mortality. So long-term PPA use can cause hypomagnesemia. So naturally, we are at a risk for all these problems. And hypomagnesemia not only causes cardiovascular disease, it also can contribute for chronic kidney disease by these mechanisms, endothelial dysfunction and enhanced expression of inflammatory mediators and so on. I am coming to the kidney disease. Proton pump inhibitor, long-term use can result in kidney disease. The two important renal syndromes, one is acute kidney injury, the other one is chronic kidney disease. And they have done certain biopsies in acute kidney injury believed to be due to PPA. It has revealed acute interstitial nephritis. These are all various published data. As you can see here, the hazard ratio ranging from 1 to 3.2 in various studies linking proton pump inhibitor use and the kidney disease. Acute kidney injury, surprising, you'll be surprised to learn that the first case report of acute kidney injury due to proton pump inhibitor was published as early as 1992, but somehow it just remained unnoticed. Subsequently, there are three major population-based studies. As you can see here, one is the USA study, the other one is Canadian study, third one is the New Zealand study. They reported higher risk of acute kidney injury linked to proton pump inhibitor. Each study involving more than 5.7 lakhs. It's a kind of a population-based studies. They all have come out with increased risk for acute kidney injury in them, ranging from 2-fold to 5-fold. And what is the mechanism of acute kidney injury due to proton pump inhibitor? It is believed to be a kind of idiosyncratic reaction. We'll never know who is vulnerable to it. It's a kind of an idiosyncratic reaction. And the time interval between the initiation of PPA and the can be anywhere between 2 to 12 weeks. This is the most important observation. What is this? Many people didn't believe how to prove that it is PPA that is causing this kidney injury. So they went ahead doing that. Now they selected a group of people in whom the acute kidney injury was believed to be due to PPI and the PPI was withdrawn. There was some recovery of the kidney function and a small cohort of them, they re-challenged PPI to see what happens. When they were re-challenged, about 7.5% of them developed another episode of AIA. So this is considered as a very, very important experiment. Human, involving humans. I don't know if that's ethical or unethical, but this is a way to prove it, right? And also there is an observation that the twice daily dosing, the more AIA is than once daily dosing. And you might ask one question, is it, does it happen with omeprazole or pantoprazole with any one particular drug is safer and all that? It is not so. It is a kind of a generalized class effect. And the disturbing fact is that most of those who suffered AKI,
there was no complete recovery. They gradually progressed to develop chronic kidney disease because of irreversible inflammation. So that is a disturbing fact. And how about chronic kidney disease? You all are aware about this ARIC, you know, atherosclerosis risk in community study. This involves about 10,400 patients followed for 14 years. In them, it's basically a kind of risk factor for atherosclerosis. But interestingly, this particular observation also was noted in this particular study, about 50% higher risk in PPA users compared with non-users in this study for CKD, when they are followed up for about 14 years. Right? And you may also ask, how are you sure that it is going to be PPA? Those who develop CKD, they may have had other risk factors, other comorbidities, for instance, diabetes, hypertension, and so many other factors. What did they do is that, this is called the propensity scores adjusted analysis. It's a kind of a multi regression, and it's a very specialized statistical methodology that takes care of these confounding variables. So they are vouching on the observation that certainly chronic PPA use increases the risk for chronic kidney disease. And also, this is important, no CKD risk is in those observed on chronic H2 receptor antagonist. And it is not just ARIC study, subsequently the Geisinger Health System study also, they have noted this kind of an association. And also there is the risk for CKD, it is increases progressively, directly proportional to the duration of PPA use, right? Why chronic kidney disease? Is it always mandatory that one should suffer an acute kidney injury, then later on that goes into CKD? It is not so. A recent observation says that even without an acute kidney injury episode, they can gradually go into straight away going for CKD. Either it can be because of repeated AKA episode, subclinical, or a chronic kidney disease pathology directly happening, or a chronic hypomagnesemia can cause a chronic renal injury. So these are the mechanisms of CKD. Right. And there are a lot of investigations, a lot of research is happening to understand, to unravel the pathomechanisms of chronic kidney disease. They all say like increased oxidative stress and accelerated senescence of the endothelial cells of the peritubular capillaries resulting in vascular artifaction, resulting in hypoxia of the interstitium that is supposed to be the important the mechanism of chronic kidney disease. And still the debate is going on. Is it just an association or causation? It's very difficult to prove. As I've already said, these are the two points which are in favor of the injurious effect of PPA on non-kidney. One is, all these observational studies, because they are population-based, cross-sectional, cohort studies, right? But they have carefully applied the statistical methodology of regression and propensity scoring analysis, ruling out the influence of other confounding variables that can cause kidney injury. This is number one. And number two, 7.5% of the patients who were re-challenged with the PPA developed AKA again. So these are the two important observations you have to keep in mind, right? And to summarize all the potential dangers of PPA, this picture shows that, a quick recapitulation, right? A chronic PPA use can lead on to acute interstitial nephritis, and then can cause severe hypomagnesemia, and the competitive inhibition of the cytochrome P450 enzyme resulting in interference with globulin action leading on to cardiovascular disease, and it increases the gastrin level, thereby increasing the chances for gastric carcinoids and colon cancer, and esophageal cancer, and pneumonia, and the chronic kidney disease, the dementia, and reduced calcium absorption resulting in bone fracture and so on. So, what are we supposed to do? As a doctor, even if I'm not able to cure, I should be able to alleviate the pain of a fellow human being. Even if I'm not able to alleviate the pain of a fellow human being, I should not harm. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to drive home the message that let us take a pledge to use PPA only when it is definitely indicated. And even in a situation where it is definitely indicated, I should use it only for the specified duration. And third, I would prefer to use a H2 receptor antagonist wherever it would suffice, rather than choosing a PPI. And those who are
study on long-term PPI, they come across, I come across them, or they come across me, I will start de-prescribing PPI. And this is called pharmacological debrima. And let us all take a pledge that we will not abuse PPI in the larger interest of the patients who are expecting us to deliver goods. Thank you very much. Thanks for the opportunity.
Any questions, sir?
Prevent the rebound. That is one point.
There are different messages. Because of want of time, I didn't elaborate on the methodologies of de-prescribing and edema. Some people, suppose for instance, he raised a very important point. Imagine somebody who's on PPA for 5 years, 6 years, and so on. We cannot abruptly stop it. It may lead on problems. What they say is that if somebody is on twice daily dose, make it once daily for some time, and then alternate day. There are different methods. Actually, there are three different methods of de-prescribing and getting the patient out of PPI.
One more last question that I just helical archipelago, Indian patients have close to about 80% of population. 80% of Indian population has Helicobacter infection. And our reinfection is extremely common because of our hygienic environment, you know, the glasses and things like that. So you are compelled to reuse and things like that. So how do you
comment on that? That's what they say. I mean, we need to understand PPA is certainly indicated in certain situations. Gastroenterologist is there around. And there are two diseases where, for a specified period, 4 to 8 weeks and so on, you know, gastric cancer, duodenal ulcer, and long-term use only for the three indications.
Barrett's esophagus,
prophylaxis against bleed in those who are on long-term NSA. But thinking that H. pylori will recur and again all that, we cannot be prescribing for long. Okay? And
Symptomatic.
In asymptomatic infection, I think giving just PPI. The studies have shown that that is not increasing the risk for chronic kidney disease and so on. Relatively safer.
What is the name?
I think this talk was really eye-opener for us who are in practice. I was talking in the, it doesn't require a quarterly history or beyond that. But I, in our practice, I was wondering, see, any new drug, we don't take our time so suddenly. We take time to take up. And this has been in the market for about 20 years or so. In fact, the first, even if a case of migraine infarction is admitted, the first thing the intern does is to give a IV prednisone. All of us have seen, even before giving morphine or IV prednisone, what are we given? Yes, this is the risk. And I have not seen a prescription across the hospital where I visit, where prednisone is not prescribed. And I'm really delighted I was here this evening to listen to. I mean, we have reports coming in of the negative effect of PPIs, but I'm really thrilled the way he put it across. But how is it that we are missing so much? All of us are used in very large numbers, but somebody who has certainly come across some such thing when we are using such large numbers, why is it that no Indians tend to say, oh, this occurred? But we never had one case reported.
In Indian Journal of Nephrology, there are publications about acute kidney injury due to proton pump inhibitor. And the chronic kidney disease is a very slowly evolving phenomenon, and we always surmise if any person we diagnose a chronic kidney disease, we think in terms of other causes for the kidney. It never occurs to us to go back and elicit history of how long the patient has been on the PKA. And again, that all the diseases for which the risk is increased due to PPA, they're all multifactorial. For instance, somebody, if I develop a fracture, I mean, I don't think that it is due to PPA. And I go ahead doing my BMT, look, check for BMT, it will be low, so I think it will osteopenia due to some other factors and so on, we start treating it. So it's a kind of a sensitization. And why it has not been very prominent in the literature is that always there is a kind of a conflict between the believers and those who don't believe, because it's very difficult to prove the entire the cause and effect relationship. It's a kind of a, all the studies which have alerted us, they are all population-based studies and observational studies. Most of them are cross-sectional studies and so on. It's very difficult to just prove. It is, that's why it has taken so much of time. I mean, long-term follow-up for more than 1.5 decades and so on.
One of the strong reasons for the delayed recognition of this side effect is the present medical society is believing evidence-based medicine sponsored by the pharma companies and then pushed by the resident society. I always quote Arthur Ashirvadam of Madurai, professor of, he said, when Western people said don't use the diabetic drugs, our stalwarts including Sam D.P. Moses, Yamama Saruja, Vishwanathan said let us use. That form of assertiveness should come back from the senior physicians of the India so that some of the adverse effects will be recognized earlier.
In media, it's no more called allopathy or in English medicine. If people think the medicine is imported from abroad and we practice it, actually knowledge is imported from abroad and we share it. So here, one best lecture, how it is called today, modern evidence-based medicine. That is what we practice and the evidences are very grown. But I am surprised if someone goes to court with one first acute injury of kidney using pantoprazole, and how many crore we have to shell out, I do not know.
No, Dr. Pramani, the President of Canada, the Certificate of Appreciation. Thank you. Now we are going